Pasito tum tum, pasito tum tum, pasito tum tum, pasito tum tum, pasito tum tum.
Hello, this is Clay Fisher, and you know what time it is? It's Little Fishy time!
Little Fishy time!
I missed you, Little Fishy. Haven't seen you so long. I know you missed me. If you didn't, I'll make sure you do by the end of this. For those of you who don't know, this is where I would usually make a montage review of what's currently playing in theaters and this summer. But because there is absolutely nothing in theaters for quarantine, I decided to ask for recommendations in my Instagram, and these are some of the few that I got. Also, you can follow me in my Instagram, which you can find in the description box. So let's begin. But before I start, let me ask you something. What year is it? 2020? Well then, how come it feels like we're in the end time prophecies of 2012? Yes, the classic Mayan calendar that predicts the end of the world. I gotta say, this movie came out 11 years too early, in my opinion. Regardless, it was outdated back then. It is still outdated to this date. So for the young kids watching this, this was a real anticipated end-time prophecy that was supposed to happen on 2012. Buzz was made out of it, churches were preaching on it, and movies were made by the guy who brought us several disaster films like Independence Day, Godzilla, Day After Tomorrow, and you can add 2012 in his resume. Maybe this director did have a dead wish to the world after all. The selling point about this movie were the special effects. If all you want to see are big buildings falling apart in a blaze of glory, you'll get your full price. But what's goofy about it are not the over-the-top destructions. It's the characters themselves, who either are despicably unlikable or make dumb decisions. People play out to be martyrs here. Why? What's the point? Who's gonna celebrate your death if the world is about to end? Dumb decisions like this doesn't make me want to save the world, it makes me want to end it as fast as possible. We're focused on this one family who are a divorced couple. Now that's another cliche on every disaster film. Why do they all have to have a breakup or a divorce as subplots? We don't care! And what's sillier is that since it's viewed from this family's point of view, they survive every single impossible outcome they could have. Earthquakes, volcanoes, tsunamis, which leads to a corny ending. You know, I have a theory. Maybe this calendar just wanted to kill this family alone. If they could have just stand still for a moment and let the calendar do its thing, maybe this world-ending problem would have been over very soon. As a whole, this was just a quick way to capitalize on the phenomenon that this prophecy gained at that time. You will get some entertainment from the destruction and some of the over-the-top characters as I did. Definitely the Russian guy was my favorite.
It's Russian.
Take it for what it is. It's a silly, over-the-top disaster film with a bunch of
flying birdies.
This is a fish. Let's just stop prophesizing to those conspiracy nuts. Now let's move into something that was considered Oscar-worthy contender. Ford vs. Ferrari, the true story of the Ford company that competed against Ferrari in a 24-hour race in order to release a revolutionary car. So it's pretty much a bunch of nameless bad guys versus Jason Bourne and the Cape Crusader. How do you think it's going to end? If there is something I can't stand about sport movies, are their insultingly predictable outcomes. We know what's gonna happen in the end. This one has a different outcome, which I can appreciate. I also appreciate Christian Bale's performance. He's the best thing in the movie, and the one who brings out the humor. Without him, this would have been a flat-out nothing. I also appreciate the look of the film. It feels like an old-school Hollywood movie from the 60s, which is where it takes place, giving credit that this is the director who did Logan. But honestly, I didn't see what was the big deal on this one. Maybe because I don't know much about cars, or maybe I just saw it as another generic underdog, outcast versus evil corporates who only want money. Or maybe I just have a high standard to racings that no one will ever top, the Little Rascals, or the Phantom Menace. It's one of those you gotta say it's good because it has Matt Damon and Christian Bale and was nominated for Best Picture. At best, it's okay. As I mentioned, Christian Bale is what makes the film watchable, and the race is, obviously, the most accelerating moment of the movie. If you were to ask me, this is just one ride I would like to take only once, and that's it.
guess it's Fish that should have sworn to Christian Bale.
Swear to me!
Let's go to another Oscar contender from this year, and one I think truly deserved it. Parasite, the winner of Best Foreign and Best Picture of the year, really unspoken of. Time will tell if this one truly does become a classic. Just like time has already told us, the Oscars will include streaming movies, and thank God for that, because if they would have stuck with their theatrical releases, we would have just had these as options. But with or without awards, Parasite leaves you with so much to talk about. It's about a poor family that sneaks their way into a rich family so they can take advantage of the comfort of the high class. And I should stop right there for those who haven't seen it. Because if I say more, I feel like I'm gonna reveal something else. The lesser you know while coming into it, the bigger impact it's gonna leave. It's a turn of surprises where you think it's about one thing and you think you know where it's gonna lead, but then goes into another direction you didn't expect. If you're not used to foreign language and subtitles, this one is easy to follow. Just like it's easy to get sucked into its suspenseful shift from dark comedy to just plain dark. It's a great commentary about social class division and figuring out who is the true parasite in the house. That's a fish! All I got for is respect.
This fact!
Speaking of foreign film, that leads me to another Oscar-winning best foreign film, Amores Perros, which is literally translated in English, Loves a Bitch. This Mexican film is what debuted Alejandro Inarritu's directorial career, and if there's something we can learn from each of his films, are the things he hates in life. He hates Leonardo DiCaprio in The Revenant, he hates superheroes in Birdman, and hates dogs. If you're a dog person, then this might not be your cup of tea, since the dogs play an intricate part to each of the three anthology stories. As it's quoted in the movie, every dog looks like its owner, and each dog reflects the heart conditions of their owners. In the first story, the dog is trained to be a dog fighter in the streets. It's violent, it's greedy, just like the love triangle with the teenagers is violent and greedy. In the second story, the dog gets trapped inside of a dark hole, just like the two couple are trapped inside their own personal dark holes in life. Lastly, in the third story, the dogs are homeless and abandoned, just like his owner is homeless and abandoned by his own family, and the only remaining family he has are his dogs. This is like Mexico's own version of Pulp Fiction, where the stories cleverly connect with each other. But they interpret Mexico from the low-class point of view. It is dark, it's filthy, it's joyless, and somehow this made me realize why we're in this new wave of Mexican films with Iñárritu and his two other amigos. Oh well, this dog truly deserves a bone to chew at. This is a fish that can take out any dog, any day. And finally, we take a look at Blade Runner 2049. This one has had a complicated history since the original came out in 1982. The original first bombed at the box office and then became popular during rentals, but it also influenced other science fiction movies like The Matrix and Ghost in the Shell. It's a favorite for the science fiction community, and honestly, I preferred the original over the sequel. Now that is no insult to the sequel. And just like the original, the sequel bombed as well at the box office for a few reasons. As a science fiction movie, it is not packed with action scenes and gun lasers. This is a long, slow-paced, cerebral movie. There's barely any talk and fully demands your patience. After all, it was directed by a French. This is not a blockbuster, and neither was the original. Though it might seem once in a while, this is a neo-noir detective film where the human robots are hunted down by the humans themselves. It's a subtle philosophical message about survival and what's the meaning of life. Now, I was hoping that I would love it as much as I've heard from the hype. I liked it. I didn't fully love it. But I do admire the respect they have for the original, to the extent of reduplicating the look of it, and at times even surpassing the visuals of it. There's moments where the visuals look gorgeous. This can work as its own movie, and it can work as a sequel that keeps expanding the story of Rick Deckard, the main lead played by Harrison Ford in the original. But don't expect them to be much in it. The main star is Ryan Gosling. So warning, this is not for everyone. It might be too long and too boring for some. But hey, it's good that we get some diversity from all these blockbusters we've had lately. Only stay away from Jared Leto, he will make you feel pandered.
I want my little fishy away from the tree hugging little.
So, if you missed any of these reviews, here's a quick recap of what I thought about all of them. 2012 is a thumbs down. Ford versus Ferrari is barely a thumbs up. Parasite is a thumbs up. Amores Perros is a dedo. Arriba! And finally, Blade Runner 2049 is a thumbs up. So, are there any other recommendations you'd like me to review? Are there any movies from your childhood? Any movies from Netflix? I'll even go further. Is there any shows you'd like me to take a look on? Leave it on the comment section down below your recommendations. And if you like this video, leave a like and subscribe for more content. Well guys, tune in next time because when I get back, I'll be giving my thoughts on what is considered the greatest movie of all time, Citizen Kane. Yeah. Until then, see you later. Ciao. Pasito tum tum, pasito tum tum.